All right. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the last day of the RIC. We're glad to be here today to talk to you about siting for new reactors in our session entitled, How Exciting It Is for New Reactors. So you have me to blame for that title. Hopefully the session will live up to its name. My name is Brian Smith, and I'm the director of the Division of New and Renewed Licenses here at the NRC. Our division is responsible for the licensing for leading the licensing reviews for license renewals, as well as for licensing of small modular light water reactors. So with me today is Kristen Kerwin, Allison Natcher, who is joining us virtually from Alaska, Martin Van Staden, and Scott Head. So I'll provide the bios for each of the speakers really quickly, and then we'll get into the presentations, followed by some Q&A. So Kristen Kerwin serves as the Environment, Safety, and Health Director within the U.S. Department of Energy, Office of Clean Energy Demonstrations, or OCED. In this role, she leads environmental health and safety compliance for OCED, a new office responsible for delivering $21.5 billion from the bipartisan infrastructure law to support large-scale clean energy demonstration projects. Kristen has over 18 years of environmental compliance experience in supporting DOE's clean energy mission. Most recently, she served as the NEPA Division Director at DOE's Golden Field office. Kristen has a Master's of Professional Studies degree in Environmental Science from the State University of New York and a Master of Public Administration degree from Syracuse University. Allison Natcher is a United States Coast Guard veteran with over 10 years of experience in hazardous materials transportation, emergency response, operations, port safety and security, contingency planning, and force readiness. She holds a bachelor's degree in history from Whitman College and a master's degree in public health with a focus on environmental health from American Military University. From 2015 to 2017, she worked with the Alaska Department of Environmental Conservation, or ADEC, on the spill prevention and response team as an environmental program specialist. Following a move to Anchorage in 2017, she transferred to the Alaska Department of Health as a health and social services planner. In 2021, Allison returned to ADEC and was appointed as the Alaska State Liaison Officer to the USNRC by Governor Mike Dunleavy. In addition to her duties as State Liaison Officer, she manages interagency coordination, conducts public outreach for ADEC, and serves as the Alaska Regional Response Team Coordinator. Dr. Martin Van Staden has a PhD from the University of Johannesburg and has 33 years of experience in the power generation industry, of which the past 25 years has been spent in the design of high-temperature, small modular reactors. He is currently the Vice President for Design Engineering at X Energy and is also the XE100 Commercial Reactor Program Manager. He leads the design team of more than 200 in-house engineers, supported by more than 30 companies who are providing support to complete the design, licensing, and commercialization of the XE100 plant. X Energy was awarded one of the two DOE Advanced Reactor Demonstration Program awards, totaling $2.4 billion to complete the design, licensing, fuel fabrication facility, and a four-reactor demonstration plant. Scott Head will be our final presenter today, and Scott has been an industry leader on NRC licensing projects for the past several decades. He spent most of his career on the South Texas Project, or STP, playing a leading role in the licensing under Part 50 of STP Units 1 and 2, and then leading the effort under Part 52 to successfully receive the COL for STP Units 3 and 4. While at STP, he also managed a licensing project for the special treatments exemptions, which was used by the NRC and the industry as the pilot for the 5069 rule change. He also directed the project team ultimately responsible for the approval of the license amendment for the NRC pilot for risk-informed completion times, which is now embodied in Tech Spec Traveler 505. Scott is currently the Business Development Director for SERTREC and serves with NPR as the Regulatory Affairs Manager for UAMP's carbon-free power project to deploy the first NuScale SMR facility at the Idaho National Laboratory. So before we get into the presentations, let me just go over a few things first. So please remember to silence your electronic devices. We will be doing a Q&A session similar to all the other sessions that you sat in this week. So if you haven't yet, please scan the QR code for those of you here in the room. If you're doing it virtually, you'll see the Q&A tab on the screen. We're also going to be doing polling questions in this session. So for those of you in the room, the slides showing the poll will include instructions for participants to text their responses. So in-person participants will text the code next to their choice to 22333. And for those of you participating virtually, you should see the tab for the polls on your screen. So since this is the last day of the RIC, I wanted to say that feedback is important to us. So please let us know what you thought about the RIC this year. Your insights help us to shape next year's program. You can provide feedback through the platform by selecting the feedback tab in the session or by accessing the link from the RIC website. So if you could post our first live polling question. Let's see. Can the AV folks do that for us? Can you post the first polling question, please? All right, well, maybe we'll move on to the first presentation and we'll come back to the polling question. So if you could start my slides.
Right.
Or do I? Oh, okay, sorry. So do you know what siting is? Yes, I'm intimately familiar. A little, but curious a little more, and no clue, or that's why I'm here. So you have only three choices this time, whereas other sessions had quite a few, so. All right, if you could go to my slides, please. So while we're bringing those up, so why a presentation on siting? Well, over the last couple of years, we've seen interest from new utilities who are new to nuclear, as well as non-utilities, such as Dow Chemical, who are expressing interest in the nuclear power now. And there's also a number of new reactor vendors that we're interacting with as well who haven't been through this process. So we thought it'd be a good idea to highlight the siting process and the challenges associated with that. And so in my presentation, I'll give a kind of a quick high-level overview of siting. And on Tuesday afternoon, there was a session related to environmental reviews. And so hopefully a lot of you attended that session as well, because that session pairs really well with the topic of siting. Okay. So this photo may not look exciting at first glance, but through the course of this panel, you'll learn why this site is exciting. So each proposed site is different from its flora and fauna to its historical significance, its geology, and its proximity to industries and populations. And that is why we're here today. Selecting a suitable site for a nuclear power plant may require a significant commitment of time and resources, including safety and environmental considerations. Site selection involves consideration of the human environment, public health and safety, engineering and design, economics, institutional requirements, environmental impacts, and other factors. The NRC governs under three laws, the Atomic Energy Act, the National Environmental Policy Act, or NEPA, and the Energy Reorganization Act. Under these laws are specific regulations that have siting requirements for new nuclear reactors. These regulations include licensing processes that fall under 10 CFR parts 50, 51, 52, and 100. Excuse me. Part 50 governs domestic licensing of production and utilization facilities and is known as a two-step licensing process, in that an applicant must apply for a construction permit and an operating license. Part 52 governs the issuance of early site permits, standard design certifications, combined licenses, standard design approvals, and manufacturing licenses for nuclear power facilities. Part 51 contains our environmental protection regulations applicable to NRC's domestic licensing and related regulatory functions. Part 100 establishes approval requirements for proposed sites for stationary power and testing reactors, subject to parts 50 or 52. A few of the relevant siting guidance documents include Regulatory Guide 4.7, or General Site Suitability Criteria for Nuclear Power Stations, probably one of the most important ones for siting. Regulatory Guide 1.206, Combined License Applications for Nuclear Power Plants. New Reg 0800, our standard review plan for the review of safety analysis reports for nuclear power plants. And New Reg 1555, the SRP for environmental reviews. As I said, this is just a few of the guidance documents related. There are many others that are specific to the different review areas that are required to be evaluated as part of siting and the overall environmental review. So the basis for siting is primarily in Part 100, which requires the NRC to consider population density, how the site will be used, including proximity to man-made hazards, and the physical characteristics of the site, including seismology, meteorology, geology, and hydrology, in determining the acceptability of a site for a nuclear power reactor. These siting factors and criteria are important in assuring that radiological doses from normal operation and postulated accidents will be acceptably low, that natural phenomena and potential man-made hazards will be appropriately accounted for in the design of the plant, that site characteristics are such that adequate security measures to protect the plant can be developed, and that physical characteristics unique to the proposed site that could pose a significant impediment to the development of emergency plans are identified. Our regulations also state that no person may begin constructing a nuclear power reactor until issuance of a construction permit, combined license, an early site permit with a limited work authorization, or the issuance of a limited work authorization itself. All right. So as I said, you have to have a license before starting construction. So what is considered construction? Construction includes the list of items that you see there on the screen, such as the driving of piles, subsurface preparation, placement of backfill, concrete, or permanent retaining walls. The general idea is that construction includes on-site, in-place activities with a reasonable nexus to NRC-regulated safety or security issues. So to provide some additional clarity, the provisions in 10 CFR 50.10A2 provide examples of what is not considered construction. Some examples include excavation and site preparation and exploration, building fences and roads. In essence, those items without a nexus to safety or security issues. If an applicant desires to start some safety-related construction prior to receiving a license, then a limited work authorization, or LWA, is required. LWAs can be used for the driving of piles, subsurface preparation, placement of backfill, concrete, or permanent retaining walls within an excavation, installation of the foundation, including placement of concrete, any of which are for a system structural component of the facility for which a combined license or a construction permit is otherwise required. The LWA review timeline is dependent upon the scope of requested activities, as well as the degree of pre-application engagement with the NRC. However, this process includes development of an environmental impact statement, review by the ACRS, and a mandatory hearing before the commission. In evaluating a proposed site for a new reactor, the NRC staff looks both inward and outward. From the looking inward perspective, the NRC considers site safety factors by evaluating the design of the facility to protect against natural phenomena hazards, that is, environmental factors that affect the design, such as earthquakes, floods, and tornado-generated missiles. The staff also considers the consequences of postulated accidents and other hazards in emergency and security planning. From the looking outward perspective, the NRC considers environmental values as part of its NEPA responsibilities by evaluating the facility impacts on the human environment, such as water use and quality, socioeconomics, terrestrial and aquatic species, and routine and accidental releases. So this graphic depicts various areas reviewed and analyzed as part of the staff's review of new reactor applications. The areas are diverse and look inward and outward with respect to the design of the proposed facility and its impact on the environment. In the site selection process, coordination between applicants and various federal, state, local, and Native American tribal agencies will be required. Information related to all of these areas on the slide will be necessary to develop an application. Some of the information will be readily available from published reports, public records, public and private agencies, and individuals knowledgeable about the site. Other information will need to be developed through on-site investigations. So this slide shows some of the prior activities that were considered by applicants for LWAs. And you can see on the screen here, and it's generally consistent with the requirements for LWAs, such that you could work on the reactor building foundation through the placement of rebar, pouring of concrete, crane foundation and retaining walls that can be abandoned in place that would then become part of the structure itself. also in other activities. So in summary, the siting review process evaluates the availability and identification of suitable sites. It depends on local specific situations, policies, and regulatory and legal structures. It may define unique critical safety and design interfaces and mitigations for adverse environmental impacts based on site-specific characteristics. The process provides early opportunities for all stakeholders to participate in the licensing process and includes site suitability determinations, which typically requires engagement of permits from state and local authorities. So this ends my presentation. Let's take a look at the first poll question results, if we could. All right, good. A lot of folks here and virtually are familiar with the siting process, but a lot would like to know more, so great. All right, our next presenter is Kristen Kerwin. While Kristen is making her way to the podium, if we could bring up our second polling question. And, all right, do you plan on going through the siting process? Yes, no, or considering it? So if you leave it up for about a minute, and then we'll get back to Kristen, and we'll look at the results of this question following Kristen's presentation.
All right, well, good morning, and thanks, Brian, for the introduction. I always find it's a lot nicer to be introduced than have to introduce myself. It's kind of like a sandwich. It always just tastes better when somebody else makes it. I think I woke up hungry today, but I can always talk about food in addition to NEPA. I'm really happy to be here to have the opportunity to talk about the Department of Energy's regulatory responsibilities related to financial assistance projects. And I'll take just a minute to give you a bit of background on the Department of Energy's Office of Clean Energy Demonstrations, which will set the scene, I think, for why I'm here talking today. OCDET is a new office in the Department of Energy, and it was established in December of 2021 as part of the bipartisan infrastructure law. As you may be able to deduce from the name, OCDET is an office focused on the demonstration of clean energy technologies. Technologies that will include advanced nuclear reactors, along with clean hydrogen, carbon management, long-duration energy storage, industrial decarbonization, demonstrations in rural areas, and on current and former mine lands, and more. It's a very exciting new office, to steal a little bit from our session name. OCDET's mission is to deliver clean energy demonstration projects at scale in partnership with the private sector to accelerate the deployment, market adoption, and equitable transition to a decarbonized energy system. OCDET was established to accelerate clean energy technologies from the lab to market and fill a critical innovation gap on the path to achieving our nation's climate goals. And OCDET is currently managing two projects in DOE's Advanced Reactor Demonstration Program. As you're probably very much aware, DOE has a long history of supporting the advancement of nuclear technology. Over the past two decades, DOE has supported several designs in different ways. And this slide here shows a montage of the advanced reactor designs that DOE, through both the Office of Nuclear Energy and OCDET, is currently supporting via cooperative agreements. DOE sees government financial assistance for new nuclear technologies as a way to mitigate the inherent technical and market risks and enable broader fleet-level deployment by domestic utilities and other power users. So the original ARDP funding opportunity issued by DOE's Office of Nuclear Energy addressed three pathways: advanced reactor concepts, risk reduction for future demonstrations, and advanced reactor demonstrations. These three pathways cover the technology maturity spectrum, with the advanced reactor demonstrations being closest to commercial viability. The X-Energy XE100 high-temperature gas-cooled reactor and the TerraPower Natrium sodium fast reactor were selected by NE for the advanced reactor demonstration pathway in fiscal year 2020. Management of these two demonstration projects was moved to OSID under the bipartisan infrastructure law, along with $2.5 billion in additional funding. And DOE is working closely with TerraPower and X-Energy on the development of these two projects and to assure that DOE's regulatory responsibilities, including those associated with NEPA, are fulfilled. And that really brings me to the heart of this presentation, which is DOE's regulatory requirements, including, but of course not limited to, NEPA for financial assistance agreements. So financial assistance is a broad term that covers various forms of assistance that non-federal entities receive from the federal government. DOE's cooperative agreements with TerraPower and X-Energy are, of course, examples of financial assistance agreements. And both the Council on Environmental Quality and DOE's NEPA implementing regulations regard financial assistance as a major federal action subject to NEPA review. So that doesn't mean that DOE is required to analyze the impact of the funding action, paying invoices, transferring funds, and that kind of thing. Rather, it means DOE is required to analyze the impacts to the human environment that will result from the actual physical work that is enabled by the federal funding. As a NEPA practitioner going on 20 years, I'll admit that NEPA is my comfort zone. It's my safe space. But as we were reminded during Tuesday's fantastic panel on NRC's environmental review processes, when NEPA practitioners like me say NEPA, we most often mean much more than just NEPA. And by that I mean, in addition to being a major federal action subject to NEPA, financial assistance is also subject to Section 106 of the National Historic Preservation Act, meaning DOE must consider how projects impact historic properties. And financial assistance requires DOE's compliance with Section 7 of the Endangered Species Act and the Marine Mammal Protection Act and more. And as I think about it, I'm not really sure why I put the Marine Mammal Protection Act as an example on this slide. It's not that likely to apply to projects that you're considering. But should anyone propose to build an offshore advanced reactor with DOE funding, you can be certain we'll be talking about marine mammals. A few regulatory requirements that are more likely to be applicable to advanced reactor projects include DOE's floodplain and wetland review requirements and the Farmland Protection Policy Act. Now, it's really important to understand that DOE is required to comply with these regulations for financial assistance actions, even if the projects are not occurring on federally owned land. Even if the only DOE nexus to your project is funding, DOE is required to comply with these regulations. Further, DOE requirements begin as soon as projects are selected for negotiation of a cooperative agreement. Prior to executing a cooperative agreement or other financial assistance award, and thereby authorizing the expenditure of federal funds, DOE is required to be in compliance with all of the applicable federal environmental regulations for the proposed scope of work. So at this point, you might be asking, so what? Why is this important? NEPA's not new. I know what the Endangered Species Act is. I've done this before. What's your point, Kerwin? Which is a question I ask myself a lot. And I guess what I really want to emphasize is that DOE cannot authorize the expenditure of federal or cost share funds for any activity until DOE is in compliance with the applicable regulations. DOE must complete a NEPA review and comply with the other requirements before project activities can be started. And project activities include everything from conceptual design to site characterization, site preparation, all the way through, obviously, construction and operation of a facility. And don't get me wrong, DOE recognizes NRC's regulatory authorities, and the NRC will be the lead federal agency in the preparation of EISs for issuance of construction permits and licensing of nuclear facilities. And DOE plans on cooperating with NRC to the extent possible in preparation of these EISs. But that doesn't relieve DOE's responsibility to complete NEPA and related requirements for activities that occur prior to NRC's authorization of construction activities. And as we all know, we're all here, we know from experience that compliance with NEPA and regulatory requirements takes time and it costs money, which means that federal compliance with these regulations has the potential to impact your project schedule and budget. And that really brings me to a discussion of best practices that can help the various federal review processes go well, minimize unnecessary impacts to your project, and enable DOE to make better, more informed decision regarding the expenditure of federal funds, which, after all, is the purpose of NEPA. Before I start talking about best practices, I want to note that none of these best practices that I'm going to talk about provide a roadmap to taking an end round around or shortcutting the process. That's certainly not my goal. DOE and all federal agencies, of course, need to balance the need to be on schedule with our duty to comply with the regulations in a way that is diligent, comprehensive, and legally defensible. To that end, I'll begin by encouraging you to start early. It's important to incorporate NEPA and required related considerations like cost and schedule alternatives, connected actions, and potential mitigation into your project at the earliest stages possible. So start thinking about NEPA early in the planning process. And if your project has federal and government or federal government involvement beyond the NRC, like agencies providing federal funding, for example, be sure to consider how the agency requirements and the timing of those requirements fit within your project schedule and budget. How should you go about doing this? That brings me to the next bullet. Communicate early and often with NEPA representatives from the federal agencies that will have a role in your project. I think it was less than an hour into the RIC program on Tuesday when I first heard the phrase communicate early and often. Chair Hansen really kind of stole my thunder on that one. I got scooped by a full 2 days. But honestly, surprises, as you know, in the world of federal environmental regulations are not fun, and they're most unwelcome. So communicating with NEPA teams at all of the federal agencies involved in your project early and often will help everyone to more fully comprehend the regulatory landscape and reduce potential for unwelcome surprises. Taking that concept a step further, you can facilitate communication between the federal agencies with involvement in your project. I imagine that all federal agencies are pretty familiar with NRC's role in the NEPA process for nuclear projects, and we all know that all federal agencies have NEPA responsibilities. But it's really important to ensure that there's communication between those federal agencies regarding each agency's proposed action and respective regulatory requirements. So as early in the process as possible, federal agencies should really be working together to establish a common understanding of each agency's roles and responsibilities and the timing of required reviews throughout the course of your project. Identify existing NEPA documents, studies, and other resources. One of the key tenets of NEPA is to not duplicate work. So think about and work with your federal agency NEPA representatives to think about whether there are existing resources that can inform the NEPA process for your project. Identify existing NEPA documents that can be incorporated by reference into agency reviews and therefore streamline the process. I would encourage you to plan sufficient time for meaningful engagement with tribal entities that might have an interest in your project. As we know, meaningful engagement takes thoughtful planning. It takes time and resources. And you can really enhance the federal engagement with tribal entities by sharing information and working to build those relationships early in your planning process. I would encourage you also to engage with stakeholders early. The point of public participation in NEPA and Section 106, for that matter, is not to send form letters to everyone under the sun and hope we don't hear back. Meaningful engagement with the public and stakeholders is critical, and it adds value to the NEPA process. So as I see it, there are two key through lines in this list of best practices: communication and planning. As entirely mundane and unearth-shattering as that might be, communication and planning can go a long way toward effective navigation of the federal environmental review processes and set your project up for success. And with that, I'd like to thank everybody for their kind attention today and NRC for the opportunity to present. I look forward to hearing from the rest of the panel. But if you have questions that I didn't answer today or want to reach out to OSID, here's an email address. I encourage you to do so. And thanks so much.
All right, thank you, Kristen. We actually have had a couple of companies come to us to talk about the potential for floating reactors. So the Marine Mammals Act may come into play before you know it. So let's take a look at the results of our second polling question. Do you plan on going through the siting process? Wow, 57% yes, some no, and others are considering it. So, all right, good. Okay, so that means the timing of our session was good to have it. So, our next person is Allison Natcher, who is joining us from Alaska. Allison, are you there?
I am. Good morning.
All right, you're up.
Great, thank you. So good morning, everybody. My name is Allison Natcher. I'm with the Alaska Department of Environmental Conservation. In this presentation, the hat that I'm wearing is the State Liaison Officer, US NRC. Next slide, please. So I get asked this question quite a bit, especially since we do have a microreactor project going on with Eielson Air Force Base. Who regulates nuclear power in the state of Alaska? So nuclear facilities are regulated by the US NRC through siting, licensing, inspection, and enforcement. However, Alaska law also includes state regulation of radiation and nuclear facility siting in Title 18, Chapter 45, Atomic Energy. This was actually originally passed in 1959, during the same year as the original Atomic Energy Act, updated in 1981 and then again in 2010. Next slide, please. So as I said, our landscape within the state of Alaska is changing. We did actually have to update Title 18, Chapter 45 in 2022. So on January 31st, 2022, Senate Bill 177, an act relating to nuclear facility siting permits and relating to microreactors, was transmitted by Governor Mike Dunleavy. And this was to go ahead and be an important step towards securing Alaska's energy independence, created a pathway for new and alternative energy opportunities throughout Alaska, ensured retention of Alaska's global leadership role with regards to sustainable microgrid technology, and then of course supporting military readiness, specifically the Eielson Air Force Base microreactor pilot project. Currently, Alaska does not have an operating nuclear reactor or a fuel cycle facility, so we had to go ahead and create these updates. Next slide, please. So this is about the Eielson Air Force Base microreactor pilot project. Speaking of communication, the state of Alaska sort of found out through open source media that this was going to be a thing at Eielson. And so it was kind of a bit of a surprise and a shock to some of us. So we weren't alerted ahead of time, but moving forward, we went ahead and we're working with the Air Force with their pilot project to develop at least one microreactor by December 2027. The microreactor will be located on Eielson Air Force Base. It was going to be commercially owned and operated and US NRC licensed. The goal is to provide the installation with clean, reliable, and resilient energy support technology for critical national security infrastructure. This is the first pilot project of its kind. And the microreactor pilot project must undergo significant scrutiny and coordination from the agencies involved to ensure its success. And this also includes working with the Alaska Department of Environmental Conservation. Next slide, please. So within Title 18, Chapter 45, Atomic Energy, we actually have a requirement that applicants have to obtain a license or permit for the activity in which the person proposes to engage from the NRC. And so this means that the person may not manufacture, construct, produce, transfer, acquire, or possess a special nuclear material, byproduct material, special nuclear material facility, byproduct, without first getting a permit and license from the US NRC. So it's actually written into our statutes. I have received questions, well, does that mean that, you know, we just go through the NRC solely, and it's no, we work in conjunction with each other. Next slide, please. So this is what we currently have for facility siting permit required. It just basically it says that you have to obtain a permit from the Department of Environmental Conservation to construct the facility on land designated by the legislature. We actually just had law go ahead and review our new siting of microreactors regulations. So I actually can speak to that finally. And so it's a bit more nuanced. We are actually requiring a pre-application and notice requirement for a nuclear facility siting permit applicant. The applicant has to have like procedures, obviously, for nuclear facility siting. We are requiring a nuclear siting permit, processing issuance, modification, termination, appeal. And so this is stuff that we're working on right now. And then also going into detail, kind of dovetailing with NEPA, is describing location requirements for a microreactor facility. Next slide, please. So as I said, the legislature is heavily involved with this, and they're the ones that actually designate by law the land in the state on which a nuclear fuel production facility, nuclear utilization facility, and nuclear processing facility may be located. Legislature needs to act in interest of regulating economics of nuclear energy and shall act to protect the public health and safety. Next slide, please. And this is basically that the Department of Environmental Conservation shall adopt regulations governing issuance of permits required by this section. However, a permit may not be issued until the muni with the jurisdiction over the proposed facility site has approved the permit. So a little bit more about Alaska. We don't have counties, we actually have munis. And then if it is not in the muni, then it is usually overseen by the legislature. Next slide, please. So here are all the updates that we went through. So again, kind of going back to the facility siting permit required, permit may not be issued until the muni with jurisdiction over the proposed facility site has approved the permit, or if the proposed facility site is located in an unorganized borough until the legislature has approved the permit. Next slide, please. So we amended this section for facility siting permit required. Person that is otherwise compliant with this chapter may construct a microreactor on land that has not been designated by the legislature. Next slide, please. So we do have the requirement to conduct studies concerning changes in law regulations with a view to atomic industrial development. And so we conduct exhaustive and continuing studies of nuclear development related risks, and then we engage with different state agencies. So it's DEC, Department of Health, Department of Labor and Workforce Development, Department of Transportation and Public Facilities, Department of Commerce, Department of Fish and Game, Department of Natural Resources, and other state agencies as applicable. Next slide, please. So we also amended this section to exclude microreactors from the ongoing study requirement in recognition of extensive research taking place inside and outside of Alaska. This includes studies that are ongoing at the Idaho National Lab. We've been working with them quite a bit. And then in addition, if the DEC received notice that a person submitted an NRC license application for a microreactor located in this state, the DEC actually goes and coordinates amongst all the different agencies within the state and submits comments to the NRC. All right, next slide, please. So this is our current DEC siting regulation timeline. This is based on the request that was made by the United States Air Force. So we did actually conduct a 30-day public scoping for regulation development and started on December 13th. It ran about 30 days. We did this because as a state of Alaska, we have a requirement that we do actually have to engage with people, discuss, you know, upcoming regulatory development, and the public does have the right to go ahead and make comments on that, but we kind of want to go ahead and socialize it initially at the beginning. So it didn't become, it wasn't quite a surprise. So we did receive multiple submissions pertaining to future development of draft microreactor siting. We received initially about 79 comments. And after that occurred, we drafted initial siting, and then of course law went ahead and conducted a thorough review. And then during that time, working in conjunction with law, we actually do have a discussion about, you know, issues, considerations, and we talk amongst ourselves within the DEC, and then of course law is heavily involved as well. Next slide, please. So moving forward, we actually just started the siting regulations formal comment period, and we're doing it 60 days. A minimum public comment period is 30, but because it's microreactors, it's new, and we want to have a lot of engagement with the public and to actually understand what their concerns are, recommendations are, we moved it to 60 days. And then the goal ultimately is to have everything finalized and adopted and signed by August 2023. Again, this is something that the United States Air Force requested that we do since they are moving forward with their Eielson project. All right, next slide. That's all I had.
All right. All right, so actually we have our final poll question up here now. Thank you, Allison, to start with there. Whose perspective would you like to learn more about? NRC, DOE, industry, or the state? So next up will be Dr. Martin Van Staten.
Well, thank you, Brian, and thanks to the NRC's RIC Organizing Committee for inviting X Energy. And from my perspective at X Energy, I can't think in the last 25 years of my involvement with nuclear that there's been a more exciting time for advanced nuclear reactors or for nuclear in general. So let me just get to advance the slides. So I'm going to quickly give an overview of our reactor because I'm not sure how much everybody knows about our design. And I think the most prominent thing about our design is our fuel that's extremely unique. So the picture on the slide there shows you one of our fuel elements. It's a graphite fuel element, and it's filled with about 19,000 triso-coated particles. And one of the big advantages of this fuel is that we can retain a really high percentage of the radionuclides within the fuel. And that is extremely important when we look at siting at the end of the day, and you'll see a bit about that. We also utilize the concept of functional containment, which means that we don't necessarily need to rely on these large physical structures and barriers to retain the radionuclides, and that we can actually meet the regulatory dose limits at site boundary without needing to rely on some of those. Our fuel uses high HALEU, We know that is a challenge, but we've already started addressing that with many stakeholders. And I think one of the big advantages of this fuel is that it allows reactor designers to look differently at how you design the plant. And so just give a quick overview of our reactor or our main power system. On the right-hand side, you see the reactor and the arrow showing the flow of helium. We use a high-temperature pebble bed reactor. We use helium as a heat transport fluid. Very important, it's not a coolant in the sense of a traditional reactor. The helium flows through to a helical coil steam generator where we generate steam. The steam is high temperature at 565 degrees C. 16.5% MPa pressure, and we've specifically designed this reactor, the power system, to provide either steam for electricity generation, so matching the temperatures of high efficiency steam turbine generator sets, or to be able to use this as a process heat application. So a very important distinction of many other reactors. I've added just a quick slide on what the reactor nuclear island looks like versus the balance of plant. And from day one, we've really purposely segregated the nuclear island from the balance of plant. And the reason for that was that we knew from day one that we're going to be designing a plant that's going to be dual use. So we could either use it for electricity generation, like the slide shows, or we could do process heat extraction. Or we could just provide process heat, depending on the temperature requirements from the customer. So that gives you a very flexible application in the design. And from a licensing perspective, we're looking at licensing what's in the gray box. And so our entire control system is based only on parameters that feed the reactor that are within the gray box. And essentially, we don't need to know what's going on in the back end from the steam side. In fact, the everything in the green box could be a mile away, depending on the type of application that we'll be applying. So why is this? This is really, for us, exciting. When you look at the site footprint on the slide there, this is a notional plant layout. This one is for a is that the water-cooled layout. We can use either dry or wet cooling. But what's important here is to look at the red line, which is showing us the protected area boundary. That's where the four reactors are. Our plant consists of four reactors and four steam generators and four turbines. So we've got a very modular approach, allowing a customer to add additional modules as required, or to be able to do sequential construction while you're operating the first reactor. And then when we look at the blue line, we are looking at an exclusion zone, emergency planning zone of around 400 meters. So depending on that site, what that means is that we believe we can meet the regulatory requirements in a worst case accident, even if we release all our helium with a small amount of circulating radionuclides in the helium to a site boundary without taking credit for things like the containment, the building, or the pressure boundary. Now, why is this important? Because it really allows us to bring our plant into closer proximity of things like a large petrochemical plant. So I've just grabbed some images off the internet there. This is not a specific plant. But we've done multiple studies where we're looking at location of our plant next to these large chemical plants. And what you're seeing in that first left-hand slide is two four-packs, so a total of eight reactors that we can place up against the boundary of a petrochemical plant and feed the steam literally over the road into that petrochemical plant. And giving you an idea of how the site footprint that we're looking at. And similarly, on the right-hand side, we've also been involved in a number of siting studies. I think the most recent one is the Warrior Run siting study just here in Maryland. That's a public. The outcome of that study is public. I think it's on the Maryland website. So you're welcome to go and have a look at that. And that's looking at repurposing of coal sites, coal-fired sites, or even we believe we're going to be repowering a lot of the gas-powered sites as well, but also showing here how we can utilize existing land and apply multiple four-packs to replace coal-fired plants. And that's where we believe the biggest market drive is going to be in these two areas in the next 10 to 20 years. So quickly go over the siting process. Brian's actually given you guys much of what's on this slide here, but really important that we've learned at X Energy, you know, there's a business case to be made, and the siting process is a key part of that. Being able to look at the engineering assessments for that site, the facilities and studies, site alternatives. We need to look at multiple sites, economic and socioeconomic studies and regulatory studies. And depending on the outcome for each of the sites you evaluate, there's a certain amount of site-specific design work that might go into that. So I'm not going to go through this slide in detail. I know we're running a bit short of time. And then I won't say much on this either. This is the regulatory process that we use to systematically assess the sites. Brian also went through that in a little bit more detail, so I'm not going to cover that in any further detail. I think what's really the most exciting to us now, and most of you might have heard in the last 2 weeks, we made the announcement that our first demonstration plant will be partnering with Dow Chemicals, and we are in the midst of site evaluation with Dow Chemicals to identify a site in the Gulf Coast area. So this is very relevant to X Energy. It's an exciting time for us to be involved in nuclear and also exciting to see the regulatory bodies like the DOE and the NRC fully engaged in this. So thank you very much. And this is just a video that'll play on. I don't need to comment on that of our site layout. Thank you.
Thank you, Martin. Let's see. Okay, this is just the question up again. We'll bring the results up after Scott. Well, we'll bring the results up now. We'll look at the results after Scott gets his presentation and we get into the Q&A.
Thank you, Brian. Good morning. It's a pleasure to be here today to talk about this very interesting and timely subject. My name is Scott Head, and I'm the Regulatory Affairs Manager for the Carbon Free Power Project. I'm going to share some perspectives today on our, including activities that we've undertaken at the site to support our application, as well as share some perspectives on limited work authorizations. I was also the Regulatory Affairs Manager for the South Texas Projects Units 3 and 4, and I hope to weave some insights with respect to that project that are relevant to today's topics. Basically a green field versus a brown field comparison, if you will. Some background on the Carbon Free Power Project. It's a Carbon Free Power Project is a wholly owned entity of the Utah Associated Municipal Power Systems, or UAMPS. UAMPS is an association of 50 public power utilities in 7 western states. Most folks in this room know that we'll be using the NuScale technology for carbon-free power project, using 6 modules that will deliver 462 megawatts of power. These modules will be essentially identical to the modules that were covered by the certified design, but with a significant uprate. This upgraded capability is addressed in NuScale's recently submitted standard design approval application. CFPP will be located in a high desert environment, and we'll be using air-cooled condensers. It'll be sited at the Idaho National Laboratory on the west side of the Idaho National Laboratory, and I'll show you some more details in a second. We are being supported and participating in a DOE cost-sharing arrangement. I mentioned NuScale submitted the standard design application in December of last year, which we will be referencing in our application. We expect the NRC review to be started on that application in the very near future, and we'll be licensed under Part 52. This slide shows the location of the Carbon Free Power Project. It'll be located on the far western side of the Idaho National Laboratory, which is a Department of Energy site. It's approximately 900 square mile site, and since the late 40s has hosted more than 50 reactors in its history, and we are planning for it to host 6 more. It's a high desert environment, and for someone like me who has lived and worked on the Texas Gulf Coast all of his life, it is a very, very interesting and fascinating area to visit. There's a timeline for that's germane or subject to today's discussion. The initial interactions regarding the project were started back in 2009. In the intervening years, discussions were held with both NuScale and DOE, and we received the DOE funding arrangements award in 2020. After a number of NEPA-required studies were performed, the site was selected in June of 2021, and we accessed the site in June of 2021. We then embarked upon and completed our seismic studies, our core boring campaign, and well drilling. Groundwater monitoring was started in February of 2022. Our cultural studies and ecological surveys are still ongoing. As I noted earlier, NuScale submitted the SDA application in December of 2021, and we expect, the NRC to initiate the review in the very near future. We expect to submit a limited work authorization in July of this year. At the same time, we will be submitting an exemption to allow us to proceed with our excavation activities. We expect to submit our combined operating license in January of next year. With respect to the theme of this session, let me make a couple of points. The time between we access the site to begin site characterization activities to support our application and our planned application date is approximately 2.5 years. Compare that to the South Texas project. The time between starting site work until we submitted our application was approximately 14 months. You would expect this time difference. At STP, we had an incredible amount of environmental data available already as an operating nuclear power plant, as well as meteorological data. The site was well characterized from a geological standpoint, and most importantly is we had an environmental report from 25 years before that had not changed that much at all and was used as our model to create the environmental report as we move forward. So if you're building an application schedule for a greenfield site, keep these differences in mind as you build that schedule. A number of people in the room are expecting to be siting, going through siting activities in the near future, and here's something you can look forward to. I say not only to you, but I would offer that that the country, as well as the local communities, hope to see these activities soon also. Activities such as a well water drilling for well monitoring, groundwater monitoring, core boring, developing and establishing a meteorological tower, and of course, tour groups. The group pictured there on the far right was in fact the team that was supporting a pre-engagement NRC site site visit by the environmental folks. My other topic today is limited work authorizations. The process is allowed by regulations, and it's a codified in 10 CFR 50.10. It should be noted that limited work authorizations have not been used many times. Searching through the dockets, you will find the Southern Company filed for two LWAs for the Vogtle 3 and 4 project, and both were approved. Progress Energy applied for an LWA for the Levy County project, which was subsequently withdrawn. And NextEra applied for an LWA for Turkey Point 6 and 7, and it was subsequently withdrawn. And I would note that we filed for an LWA at the South Texas project, but promptly withdrew it and pursued an exemption instead. An important aspect of the current rule is because of the rule change in 2007, as Brian noted earlier, excavations, except under certain circumstances, do not require an LWA. I would draw your attention, if you're contemplating it, to read the SECI 07-0030, in which the NRC provides a detailed argument why applicants should be able to proceed with excavations without NRC approval. It's a very good read. Under certain circumstances, depending on the construction technique, you might need an LWA for an excavation or at least an exemption. An LWA supports a major federal action, and as such, will require a NEPA review, which will need to be supported by an environmental report, and an LWA will need to be supported by a safety analysis. The LWA process requires a mandatory hearing. It's also a lengthy process. The NRC's generic published schedule states that an LWA could take up to 36 months to approve, which will lead me to my most important point of my presentation. If you plan to be an applicant, you need to avail yourself of the opportunity of pre-application engagement meetings with the NRC. In these interactions, you can share your plans and identify crucial issues and you see with your application and receive NRC feedback. It was during a series of these interactions that we ultimately developed a plan that we now expect our LWA to application to be completed in substantially less than 36 months. That completes my presentation, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Scott. So we go bring up the results for the final poll question. Whose perspective would you like to learn more about? It's pretty even across the board. All right. So we do have a few questions, and we do have plenty of time to address the questions that we have. If you could put the QR code back up so that the folks here in the room could scan that if they didn't have time beforehand. And we'll start with the first question that we have here. This is for the panel. With coal to nuclear transitions identified as a promising application for advanced reactors, what consideration is given to potential CERCLA liabilities? How do companies plan to address the assumption of liability? I assume that has to do with the cleanup of the coal plant and the ash ponds. Does anyone want to try to address that? From an NRC perspective, I'll attempt to address it. I know we're starting to look at the coal to nuclear transition and the different issues that may bring up. Ash ponds is clearly one of them. Looking at it from a total site decommissioning standpoint, does that have to be factored into the decommissioning plan for the applicant or not? Is that handled separately? The radiation aspects from the ash pond as well is something that we're starting to look into as well. Does that have to be taken into account when they do the original site surveys for the application? But the NRC are just starting to look into some of those issues now. So, okay. So a question for Allison. Did Alaska use guidance from legislature passed in other states when revising its atomic energy regulations, and are any elements of it in conflict with federal laws passed in the 1960s and 70s? Any thoughts on how those old laws may be updated for modern times?
All right, good morning, thank you for that question. We actually did, so it was a group effort. I am with spill prevention and response, so that's where I kind of fit in my organizational chart. The other side is environmental health, and so we worked in conjunction with each other to kind of go ahead and address these new regulations and new sightings specifically. We did actually go ahead and talk with law. I, from my end, went ahead and I actually talked with different state liaison officers, and thanks to every single one of them that agreed to speak with me. So I spoke to different groups, different people, a lot of stuff from California, for instance, and a lot of different information coming from Connecticut. A lot of my other state liaison officers provided insight. And also we went to and looked at utility siting regulations as well.
Okay, great, thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, a question for Kristen. Considering the diverse portfolio at OCED, how large an office is this, and what fraction are dedicated to the ARDP projects, and what sort of interaction is there between the different portfolio managers? And does OSED, as you called it, perform the NEPA evaluations for these projects, or do the applicants, or does DOE, and if OSED does not perform the activity, then what does OSED do to facilitate? So basically, if you could just talk a little bit more about OSED, description of it, and how you handle the environmental reviews.
Sure, I'm happy to. That's a great question. I think I'll be better able to answer the NEPA portion of that question than the OSED portion. ARDP makes up a good portion of the OSED staff. All of the provisions in the bipartisan infrastructure law, as well as the IRA, have staff in OSED. They're supported. The program staff are supported by the ES&H group, as well as financial assistance, grants agreements officers, legal counsel, and the like. So we're a rapidly growing organization and really working together to support the execution of the provisions under bill. With respect to NEPA and who does NEPA, in financial assistance agreements, it's most common to have a three-party agreement. So applicants hire NEPA contractors. The NEPA process can be funded with approval from the contracting officer with project funds. And the applicant, DOE, and the NEPA contractor work in a three-party agreement where the contractor is paid by the applicant but produces a DOE document. We have a memorandum of understanding or agreement letter that we line out very clearly the roles and responsibilities in the NEPA process and what we expect the process to look like. And that's typically how it's handled in financial assistance agreements.
Okay, great, thank you. So a question for me. So Brian, the laws involved here date from 1954 to 1974, yet the siting regulations continue to evolve over time. Are the laws in need of updating and consolidation, or is there sufficient leeway in interpreting these laws to justify past updates and future updates without further congressional oversight? Well, the laws, even though they were dated from 1954, 1974, continue to be updated as Congress sees fit, and will probably always have congressional oversight. I haven't heard of any discussion on the need to change the laws with respect to siting. We take those laws and we put them into the regulations and provide additional requirements in there as well. I think there is sufficient flexibility to make changes to the guidance and how we interpret our regulations and enforce those regulations. And we're doing some of that now. Scott mentioned it earlier, and I think Martin did as well, in that we did a SECI paper back in 2020 addressing population-related siting considerations for advanced reactors and proposing to the commission that we modify our guidance to take a more risk-informed technology performance-based approach. We are working on guidance to the commission to respond back approving the staff recommendation in that paper. We do have some draft guidance that we hope to get out, I believe, next month that will help the industry potentially locate plants closer to more densely populated communities than what the guidance currently allows for now, certainly as Martin showed in his graphics. We've also been looking at our environmental guidance. We have an advanced reactor GEIS, generic environmental impact statement, that's up with the commission now for review. That would help somewhat streamline the environmental process, the review process from both the applicant's perspective as well as the NRC's perspective. We also issued what we call an interim staff guidance related to microreactors a couple of years ago as well, from looking at it from an environmental perspective, how because of the small size and the small impact on the environment and potentially small releases, you could do a scaled environmental report to be able to submit to us, and we could in turn scale our environmental impact statement that we have to do to address that. So there are a number of ways in which we are making the process a little more efficient by modifying our guidance without having to modify the actual regulations or the laws associated with that. So a question for Scott. How can the LWA process be made more efficient and coordinated with the COL process?
Well, one of the parts about the LWA process, which I didn't mention, but you do all your work that you would embark upon an LWA at risk. There is no presumption that you will get and receive a combined operating license. In doing it at risk, you also have to create a redress plan in case you don't receive your license or you withdraw from the project. So what puzzled me when we first started looking at the LWA process is the need for the mandatory hearing. It's affiliated with the fact that it's part of a construction permit, but there will be a mandatory hearing for the COL as part of the COL application. And it seemed like if you're doing it at risk and you have a redress plan, that requiring a mandatory hearing in that extra 4 months of time or more, potentially, is really probably unnecessary and duplicative. And so that's something to consider because as you noted, it's not been used many times, and I think the length of time is part of the issue with the LWA process. That's one thing at least.
Okay, thank you, Scott. All right, so a question for the panelists. To all the panelists, what are the biggest barriers to timely siting reviews in each of your domains?
I can maybe start, and I see Milton
Gordon, our siting manager, is smiling. One of our biggest challenges, obviously, is number one, getting a plant owner so that you can get to a site. You know, I think that's, from an advanced reactor developer perspective, been one of the big challenges. So I don't see it as being a regulatory issue. It's about having industry commit to building a plant and getting a committed site so that we can actually start these processes. I think the processes from a NEPA and from a we will be looking at a construction permit approach using the Part 50 route. But just getting a site so that you can actually start these processes is most probably one of the biggest hurdles we've faced over the last couple of years. And so that's why the excitement from X-Energy's perspective, signing Dow Chemicals as a customer, we will be announcing the actual site within, I think, about the next 2 months. So Dow is working the stakeholder engagement, and as soon as that's been completed, we'll be making that announcement. So I don't know, Milton, if you want to add anything there, but I think from our perspective, that's probably the biggest hurdle we've faced.
So I would agree for a greenfield site. You know, determining the location of the plant is a very lengthy process, and I don't know that it can be, you know, especially on a greenfield site. I don't know how much it could be made shorter, but it may be helped if you have someone that you already have as a target applicant. So, but it's part of NEPA, and it's part of the work you have to go through, and. So I accept, but it is a significant part of the process.
Allison, do you want to add anything?
All right, well, I'll answer. And I guess my answer isn't specific to either of the ARDP projects that DOE is, or that OSIT is supporting. It's specific more to project development in general, and it's, it echoes what Martin just said is, you know, we can't really begin NEPA without a site. NEPA is site specific, and we can't finish anything that we don't start. And so absolutely the number one important thing in starting and finishing a NEPA review in a timely manner is identifying a site, not changing that site, and gathering the specific details needed to do a detailed and thorough analysis.
All right, thank you. I would just say from an NRC perspective, I'll make another plug here that you've heard multiple times in this, Rick, is pre-application engagement. So don't wait until you have your application ready before you come in and talk to us. None of the applicants are doing that. They're coming in and they're talking to us well in advance. We've been talking to CFPP for a number of years now, X-Energy as well. Not just from the safety perspective, but also the environmental folks. We got some of those folks here in the room with us today. Come in and talk to us. You have questions about the siting aspects, the environmental aspects. We're here to help. So a question for me. What is the purpose of the safety application and safety review for an LWA, considering the LWA work is performed at risk of the applicant, is subject to redress, and the LWA has no bearing on issuance of a CP or a COL? So I would say it goes back to like the definition of construction and what is considered construction. And the LWA covers those things that fall under the definition of construction. And so that means those activities have a nexus to either safety or security portions of the facility. And so that's why we have to do a safety review as well as part of the LWA review process, taking into consideration all of the geology and the seismology and all the other ologies we have to look at in the design of the facility itself. All right, so a question for Scott. You mentioned that the 25-year-old site characterization reports for STP were a great template. In your opinion, would the data have been helpful if it were not a nuclear pedigree? I'm thinking about reuse of data from an old coal plant for a new nuclear plant. based on your experience, do you think that site characterization data associated with an old coal plant would offer much value?
Well, it certainly could. You need to explore all options and all potential information that's available to you. So it's certainly better than, the people there have a lot of experience already, and you should avail yourself of that. I would note that with our project, DOE and its contractors had an incredible amount of cultural, ecological, environmental data that was available to us. It really jump-started our preparation for the environmental report. And so if you have that information available to you, then you certainly should find some way to use it. And I would expect some of that information even at a coal plant would be available to you to use.
Martin, you said you were part of a review that looked at coal plants in the state of Maryland.
Yep.
Is that something you evaluated as part of that?
We didn't go to that extent yet. There was some environmental data available, but I think the review we did was a higher level, fit for site application for the Warrior Run site. We didn't have a lot of environmental data available from that site at all. It just didn't make any difference at this point.
Right. I know the Department of Energy did a study in the last year as well, looking at the reuse of coal sites for nuclear plants, and actually identified, I guess, a couple hundred of those using various criteria. I mean, I haven't really had a chance to look at that in detail. I imagine they looked at the amount of environmental information available as well as part of that. So. Okay, another question for NRC staff or for myself. Does NRC consider floating reactor siting? So, as I mentioned earlier, floating reactors is something we've had a couple of companies come talk to us about. In those cases, those are gonna be like stationary and not on ships, but kind of permanently moored in a bay type area. The same siting requirements would apply to a floating reactor as well. If it was gonna be stationary, if it's gonna be a ship, that's mobile, that's something else. We'd have to look into that. So this was where the Marine Mammals Act may come into play. So there's a lot of different other aspects, especially the aquatic life that may be around. So another question for me. What are NRC's thoughts on fast-tracking the siting process for new nuclear on existing facility land? We haven't thought of fast-tracking the process. The process is what it is, but by choosing to site on an existing reactor site, you're going to have a lot of the same information as Scott mentioned earlier in his presentation at STP. That will make your information gathering, your application preparation that much quicker. And being it's information that we're, as an agency, probably already familiar with, that would help our review process as well. So that could then, in turn, speed up our review process and getting documents out more quickly.
So, Brian, could I add to that?
Sure.
So this response is really, 15 years old, but it's germane now to what we're looking at as an industry. My first real NEPA experience was on STP 3 and 4, and when I encountered the question and issue of alternative sites, that I was quite puzzled about why that would be an approach you would have to have for an existing nuclear power plant, that we had to go try to find an obviously superior site to something that already has a nuclear power plant on it. The environmental impacts are already established and well known, and to embark upon that, knowing that the probability of finding that obviously superior site was essentially zero, seemed like a significant waste of time and effort. That's not applicable to the carbon-free power project. We embarked upon from the very start. But with respect to coal plants and other things that we're attempting at this point in time, it seems like that there ought to be a categorical dispensation or some sort of screening that could take place, that If you're building or offering to build a nuclear power plant on a previously significantly disturbed with the infrastructure and everything else is there, the answer ought to be obvious that the probability of finding a superior site to that one is so low. But the counterpoint is that I will guarantee you, you will, when you publish these alternative sites, the communities in that area will find out about that, and they will now think that there's a potential they're going to build a nuclear power plant, you know, in my community. Now, that'll be both a positive and a negative reaction. You would expect that, but it doesn't seem like, given what you're offering to do, that to embark upon that course for either a nuclear power plant or a coal plant or, you know, a chemical plant like Dow, is something that's that there ought to be another option, I think, in circumstances like that.
Yeah. So public outreach, that is something Allison mentioned it in her presentation about getting surprised about what the Air Force was planning to do at Eielson Air Force Base. In my past here at the NRC and doing licensing of big projects, I've seen it done poorly and done really well, actually by the same company. They had such a negative experience that they completely changed their ways when they chose their next site, and the community really welcomed them with all of the outreach and explanation and information they provided to them. So that to me, that's key in your process as well. Interact with those around the area where for the site that you selected early and often.
Can I make a comment regarding that, please?
Yeah, go ahead, Allison.
Great. So obviously with a microreactor, you know, specifically for Eielson, you know, it was a surprise to the community. The Air Force did hold a town hall, and quite a few people said, you know, we felt like we were just voluntold, like, congratulations, you're getting this. And so to the Air Force's credit, they said, you know, we made some mistakes, and here's how we're going to improve things moving forward. So they actually have a dedicated website now. They're actually posting videos and doing a lot more engagement with the people of Fairbanks. So I did want to give them credit for that. But in addition, the state of Alaska, we're actually developing a roadmap, and part of that roadmap for microreactors is basically community engagement. You know, what does that look like? How do we get people to engage? How do we bridge that gap between the vendors, the, you know, local communities, tribes? That was a huge part of that. And also, you know, how do we get, you know, specialists basically from University of Alaska Fairbanks also to be able to have these conversations and have it be meaningful? So as I said, just it's really important to go ahead, have these conversations, but also recognize that, you know, transparency is also key. Otherwise, if you don't have these conversations early and often, you might encounter a lot more roadblocks.
All right, great. Thanks, Allison. We have time for one more question, which is for me, and then I'll get into some closing remarks. So will the NRC be more proactive in consultation with tribes early in the siting process? For example, in pre-application, NRC becomes aware of several potential sites. Industry would already be engaging but cannot represent government consultation. Is the NRC prepared for this early engagement ahead of accepting an application? And I would say yes. That was a big topic of discussion in the panel on Tuesday afternoon. Ken gave an example of how they went out to the state of Idaho and met with the tribes out there in relation to the carbon-free power project. So I know we plan to do more of that as more sites are selected and in the future. So we have like 30 seconds left. So I want to thank all my panelists. Great job. Thank the audience for some really good questions. We covered a lot of topics, and I want to go over a couple of key takeaways for me. The siting process is not simple, and it can take a significant amount of time. The siting process can take a lot of coordination with state and local officials, as well as your Native American tribal governments, which we just talked about. The state and local requirements can vary. Allison went through just what's going on in Alaska. Every state is going to have its own nuances, so you're going to have to take that into account. And also, finally, whether locating on a DOE site or receiving funding from DOE, the DOE has NEPA obligations that it has to do itself as well as us. So in that case, it's early to come talk to us early so we can coordinate our NEPA efforts to make sure it's the most efficient. So with that, the session is closed. Thanks, everyone.